is found in Revelation 19:9. And this is an angel speaking to John. Not John the Baptist, but John the Revelator. And this angel tells John, and he said unto me, this is John speaking, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. If you read a slightly more modern version, and if we go, for example, to that same chapter in Revelation 19:9 and look at the New Living Translation, that same verse says, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding feast of the Lamb. And the verse doesn't end there. It goes, and then he added, these are the true words that come from God. Oh Lord, I ask you at this moment that you may speak to us and that you may help us see and think and realize how important it is to one day sit with you at that table and spend that glorious moment at that feast with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It was Jesus himself who once, with his own mouth, made the promise that he would one day eat with you and eat with me. And he gave it to the disciples when he was at the Last Supper. And if you look up Matthew chapter 26, verse 29, here we find Jesus at the very end of that supper, of that holy supper, his last one here on earth with his disciples, telling them this, Matthew 26:29, I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. I love how the New Living Translation puts that same verse. It says, mark my words. I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Mark my words. Mark Jesus' words. One day, you also have an open invitation to drink that wine with Jesus and to eat that supper with him. It is extended to all of us. And what is it so? What is so special about this supper, this promised supper in Revelation? If we jump back to the book of Revelation, chapter 19, verse 9, there are a few, perhaps, clues as to why this big gathering matters. And if we jump forward, or back rather, a few verses ahead to verse 6 and read from there, we see some glimpses of what that very great day will be. And it says, then again I heard what sounded like the shout of a vast crowd, or the roar of mighty ocean waves, or the crash of loud thunder. So this is like a big roaring sound. And it said, praise the Lord, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. This is a small nerd parenthesis that I'd like to make. That verse that we read, praise the Lord, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. There you see, holy, 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 the name God, three times repeated, because the Bible loves to do things like that, repeat the name in threes to signify how truly awesome he is. Verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him, for the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself. She has been given the finest of pure white linen to wear, for the fine linen represents the good deeds of God's holy people. And then comes the verse that we've been reading. And the angel said unto me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding feast of the Lamb. These are the true words that come from God. The fact that God told John, and John emphasized that, write it. Write this down. Put it down. Mark it. Make a circle around it. Don't forget. This feast is coming. Don't forget. Write it. Mark it on your calendar. Put an alert on your phone. There will be a feast. And not just that, but at the end of the verse, he says, these are the true words that come from God. This is not a joke. This is reality. This is going to happen because he said that it would. And because we have that alert, because we have that notice, no one here can say, oh, but I didn't know. Everyone has the invitation. In the book of Matthew, Jesus kind of also gives a hint of when that feast will come. And he says that the word of this kingdom shall be preached unto all the world, and then the end will come. Once all the world knows and hears of this Jesus, then, once everyone receives the invitation, then the end will come. And that's interesting because many of us, and I'm sure this has happened to you, I know I do it all the time, well, maybe not all the time, sometimes. We get invitations to go places. In my professional life, I get a lot of invitations to attend events, to go to things that people want me to be there. For those of you who may know, I'm a reporter, a writer. I write about things for a living. So people like when writers go to things because they assume you're going to go and cover it. I was at this event on Wednesday, and everyone was asking me, when is your article coming out? And I'm like, no, there's no article coming out. I'm just here, you know? People expect writers to just bang out articles about their events, but I just go because I like to, you know, be nice to people, but it doesn't mean that I'm going to write something about their event. But it also happens because I get all these invitations that I don't make many of them. And sometimes I even say, RSVP, yes, I will be there. And I am one of those whose little name tag is at the table and never shows up because something came up. And sometimes that happens too. When you're reporting or writing about things in the world, news break at 5 o'clock the day of the event, and you can't make it. You know, sometimes duty calls and you can't make certain things. So people understand that. And in a similar way, many of us know about this invitation that Christ makes to us, but we don't heed the call. We don't listen to it. We're not aware. We suddenly forget that we're nothing but pilgrims in this world, passing through. We're just temporary travelers going through this earth, but that we have something else awaiting us. We forget that our treasure isn't here, but in heaven. We forget that all of this stuff and the things that we're preoccupied by and with are nothing but something that vanishes. King Solomon called all of these things vanity, vain things that just go with the wind. And a lot of us are just caught up in that wheel and forget that there is something greater awaiting us, that there is an open invitation to the greatest wedding feast that we ever. And part of the reason that we forget that that invitation is open and waiting for us is because of something we read a few moments ago. In verse 7 of Revelation 7, in verse 7 of Revelation 19, it says, "Let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him, for the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself." Many of us aren't ready for that feast. We haven't prepared ourselves. In Bible theology, the bride of Christ is us. We're all the body of Christ. We're all his bride. But we're not married yet. That's the interesting thing. We may have independently made a commitment to God. You may have one day said, "Yes, Jesus, I will follow you. I pledge allegiance to you until the very end." But collectively as a church, we are not yet there. We haven't together as one church, yet received our groom. We're looking forward to that day. We're looking towards the moment that he appears. But in the meantime, the job is to get ready. Just like those 10 virgins that were waiting in the Bible for the groom to come. They were waiting. Their only job was to have oil in their lamps and wait and be ready, because at any moment the groom could appear. So now the question becomes, are you personally ready to meet the groom? Don't look to the side. Don't look to your brother, your mother, your sister, your husband, your wife. Think of yourself. If God were to come tomorrow, would you recognize his voice? Would you know that he's calling your name like a shepherd calls his sheep? Would you heed his voice? And if you are attuned to his voice, you will recognize it because you're used to it. You spend time with God. We ought to be ready, just like the bride is ready. I am not going to exaggerate when I tell you what I'm about to tell you, but I kid you not, the most beautiful bride I've ever seen in my life was Stephanie on the day of her wedding. It's true, and I'm not telling you this because I'm biased, although I am. But
smart man.
But she was dropped that. Well, I actually cried when I saw her walking down the aisle. I did. You should just see pictures. I'm like a hot mess. But then she told me what it took to go in there. And I'm like, oh my goodness, no wonder. It was a production. And it should be. It's the biggest day. It can be the biggest day for a woman, the day of her wedding. And I do remember, even though I was not allowed to see her dress or any of the things she was going to wear that day that was sacred, and I was completely blind to all of those preparations, I did in the background see like all the things that she had to do and meet with people and choose vendors or whatever, and hair, makeup, and things that I had no idea about. But I knew that a lot of thought went into it, and with good reason. Because a bride, no offense, reference to the groom, but that day is all about the bride. That's why when she walks in through the door, everyone stands. And it's like, wow. Nobody cares about the groom. You know, it's the black tux or whatever. I look really boring that day. Nothing special. But the bride is the one that turns all the heads. She needs to be ready. We need to be ready. And that takes work. That takes effort. And we're all different. We're all different elements of this church. But we all play a role in getting us ready to be there. If you're here this morning at Princeton SDA Church, whether you're visiting, whether you're a member, whether you're a new member, and welcome to those members who we just accepted by transfer into our midst. Everyone who is here today plays a role in getting the church ready for that moment when Jesus appears. Because all of us, in a sense, we're in this together. We're all in the same boat. And we ought to look out for each other's faith, and each other's walk. And in a sense, God will hold us accountable for that. Salvation is personal. No doubt about that. Salvation is always personal. You're only going to be held responsible for you, where you stand today in your walk with God. But we're also, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another, says the Bible. In a sense, we're also called to help each other. This wedding that's coming up is with someone really special. And the verse that we've been reading refers to the groom with a very curious word. What is the groom called in Revelation chapter 19, verse 9? Anyone wants to shout it out? What is the name of the groom?
The Lamb.
The groom is a lamb. We will marry a lamb. Why a lamb? Why not a lion or something more magnanimous? Why does it have to be a lamb? Now, in any book of the Bible, we might have expected that our Lord would not have been called the Lamb. It might seem the name the Lion of the tribe of Judah might appropriately have been used every time instead of the Lamb. So why the Lamb? The Lamb is because that's exactly the way Jesus' disciples saw him depart. Their last memory of Jesus before he left this earth. He came as a human and he left as a human. Jesus told them, the same way that you're seeing me now leave and ascend into heaven, you will see me return. In the same manner. Yes, I will come in glory, but I will be the same person. The moment Jesus came to this earth and he shed his divinity for humanity, the moment he became like us and then gave his body to be slaughtered, then we saw with our own eyes how important the term the Lamb was. The Lamb was what the people of Israel needed day in and day out to be forgiven. The Lamb was what they had to sacrifice in order to get remission and forgiveness for sins. Without the Lamb, they could not be saved. It took Jesus to become that Lamb and give himself for all of us to then give us full access to his glory. It was a huge, gigantic sacrifice. It is as the Lamb that Christ most fully displayed his love for his church. It was a huge, major sacrifice. And that's how he showed his love for us. No greater love. Does anyone know how the verse goes? There's no greater love than this, that a man should give his life for his friend. Because the Lamb gave his life, and there's no greater manifestation of that love. It's because his title, now and forevermore, is that. It's the title of the Lamb. And he wants for us to be ready. As we read, he wants for us to be prepared. Because when he comes, he wants for all of us to meet him. The promise, the invitation that he extended is for all of us. He wants all of us to be seated at the table. Everyone received the invitation. And he doesn't wish that any of us should perish. He wants all of us to proceed to repentance and to make it into his kingdom. Because he did that and he extended the invitation, he wants for that marriage ceremony, when it finally occurs, that big public display of love to include all of us. And he doesn't want anyone to be left out. So my calling for each of us this morning, or now afternoon rather, is that we work on the preparations for when that day comes. He wants for all of us to display the qualities that we read in the verse. Verse 8, this bride, us, she has been given the finest of pure white linen to wear. For the fine linen represents the good deeds of God's holy people. Many times at this church, we have exhorted each other. We have told from this very pulpit that the way we achieve those good deeds of God's holy people is not by anything good that's in us. There is absolutely nothing we can do to achieve salvation. And that's what we've been learning in Romans through the Sabbath school. You cannot earn your way into heaven. You cannot buy your way into heaven. You cannot do good deeds and hope to earn heaven. So how do you achieve these good deeds that represent the white linen, these beautiful garments that the bride will wear? That's simple. It is a response from you, personally, from all of us. Is it a response from someone who already loved you first? You love someone back because they already show you the greatest love that there is. And the only way you obey, the only way you live a life for Jesus is because you realize, oh my gosh, he already did everything. He already loved me. He already lived the life that I couldn't live. And the only response left for me to do is to love him back. The book of Psalms says that the kindness of the Lord